Welcome to episode 11 of the Connectome Podcast. Now today I am really excited because we've got not one, not two, but all three winners of 2013's Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine. Harvard cell biologist James Rothman, Berkeley cell biologist Randy Schekman, and Stanford neuroscientist Thomas Südhof. Over the past 30 years, these guys have been friends, competitors, and co-discoverers of the molecular machinery that enables our brains to move information from one place to another. And they are all here on the Connectome Podcast today to tell their stories. If you're into neuroscience at all, which you probably are if you're listening to this, you know that neurons, nerve cells, communicate through connections called synapses. And you might also know that neurotransmitter chemicals like dopamine and serotonin get passed from one neuron to the next in little hollow globs of proteins called synaptic vesicles, which bud off from one neuron's membrane and then attach to the next neuron's membrane, open up, and release their payloads. Now, biologists have known that this vesicle transmission process happens since at least the 1960s. But the incredible thing is that well into the 80s, nobody knew how it worked. In other words, nobody knew exactly how these synaptic vesicles, these globs full of neurotransmitters, found their way to the right spots on the membranes of receiving neurons. Nobody knew what hooked them into place on the receiving neurons, or how, or what triggered them to open, or timed that process, or how. Nobody had any idea how any of this worked. And it wasn't for lack of trying. There were a lot of theories floating around, but nobody seemed to be able to isolate the specific chemicals that did it, or describe the process in any detail. And as James and Randy and Thomas are about to describe to you, the quest for the answer turned out to involve not just neuroscience, but also cell biology, biochemistry, genetics, and believe it or not, the life cycle of yeast. I'll start by asking you, Randy Schekman, how did you first get hooked on biochemistry?
Well, I was a science nerd all the way through high school. I lived for the annual science fair projects. I wasn't into sports or anything. So I just found that I naturally gravitated to biology, microbiology especially, and thought that the natural outgrowth of that would be to go to medical school. So when I started at UCLA, I was a pre-med, but I quickly discovered that there was a whole world of science that was reflected in the university that I wasn't really aware of. And most importantly, in freshman chemistry, I did well enough to be in an honors section the last term of the year, and they put me in a class taught by Willard Libby, a famous chemist who invented carbon-14 dating.
Oh, wow.
He himself was actually an awful teacher, but the advantage of the class was that we were assigned to a research laboratory in the chemistry department at UCLA and had to kind of apprentice for a term. And I was assigned to a molecular biology lab, just by chance, of an assistant professor. And he said, well, you need to read up on this field. So he gave me a book called The Molecular Biology of the Gene. It's a famous book by Jim Watson, but this was the first edition. It had only just come out. This was the spring of 1967. And to me, it was a revelation. I mean, I would read the book in my leisure, almost like it was a Bible. And I just got completely absorbed and the idea of studying cells this way.
What was it about that particular book that fascinated you so much?
Well, it was the narrative was incredible. He's a gifted writer, and it's just the idea that you could study life processes with this new biology. Really, it was not classic biology. It wasn't really biochemistry. It was it was molecular biology. It was really the birth of molecular biology, but long before cloning. Anyway, it was. It was an influential book, and so I decided in my sophomore year to look around for a regular research lab, and so I found one. I became really engrossed in the study of DNA replication in the laboratory of another assistant professor in the zoology department at the time, and I spent most of my time in the lab, stopped going to classes. My grades started to suffer, but I got publications out of my undergraduate
work. Nice.
So I was hooked. But I decided, as a result of my experience, that I needed more exposure to real biochemistry, as opposed to just sort of cell physiology, bacterial cell physiology. And so I sought out the best in the business, Arthur Kornberg, and was admitted to Stanford and joined his lab, where I worked on DNA replication. So anyway, that was the most, of course, most intense exposure to my discipline, and I learned from him, really the master, how to take apart a process piece by piece and how to really focus on a problem and persist until a satisfactory level of resolution was achieved. So that was a great experience. I did very well, but I felt at the end that I wanted to move on and not stay in that field because, frankly, it was really dominated by him. And I guess in the back of my mind, I'm stubborn enough that I didn't want to simply be known as a former Kornberg student. I wanted to be my own person. So I became exposed in the course of my time there to membranes. Kornberg had an interest in membranes because he thought, before I started, that replication might be organized on a membrane surface. It turns out it wasn't really, and so he sort of lost interest in membranes. But my best friend at the time, still my best friend, Bill Wickner, had come from a membrane lab, and so I really was sort of immersed in that, in his excitement in it. And so I developed my own ideas about this, and I went to a guy by the name of S.J. Singer, John Singer, in UC San Diego to do my postdoc and learned about sort of what people were thinking about membranes. But I didn't particularly like the project that I was on or the system that I was using, and so when I started at Berkeley in 76, I was influenced by Lee Hartwell and his genetic dissection of the cell division cycle in yeast. So I thought that I could combine my biochemical experience with that genetic approach and tackle membrane assembly in yeast. Though I had no experience working with yeast and no real experience doing genetics. So I took the Cold Spring Harbor course in yeast genetics for 3 weeks. You know, I thought I was an expert, but the NIH didn't think so. My first grant was trashed. But I had some funds, and I was fortunate to get a really terrific technician, Charles Field, who knew yeast genetics certainly more than I did. And I had a wonderful first graduate student, Peter Novick, who was really quite accomplished already. And then we set off to look for mutants that block secretion with the assumption that secretion would be intimately linked to cell surface growth in yeast. So we expected that anything that really blocks secretion would also block cell growth, thus mutations would be lethal. So we focused on isolating temperature-sensitive lethal mutations. And we putzed around a little bit, trying to set up a selection procedure that ultimately failed. And then we decided that we would just screen a random collection of temperature-sensitive mutants. And out of a couple of hundred, we already found two bona fide sec mutants. 23 genes came out of that screen, and we published that paper in 1980. Ultimately, my goal, since I was a biochemist, was to, like James Rothman, to set up a cell-free reaction that reproduces significant steps in the pathway.
Very cool. James Rothman, how did you first get into biochemistry and neurobiology?
Well, my background, go back a few steps, the problem that I was recognized for having solved, in some ways is the problem that I set out to solve, and in many ways not. My early interest in science was math and physics. I was an undergraduate at Yale, where I'm now a professor. I was absolutely intent on becoming a theoretical physicist right the way through most of Yale, up through almost the end of my junior year. My father was a physician. He came very close to insisting that I take a course in biology. As a proper physicist, I was educated to the idea that all physicists are stupid. Chemists are less stupid, and only physicists have, especially theoretical physicists, are intelligent. So I rejected the idea. He insisted. I went to a couple of lectures of the introductory biology course when I was a junior, and I was immediately hooked. I got hooked on biology. I graduated from Yale, still a physics major.
Oh, what was it about cell biology that was compelling enough to lure you away from physics?
Ah, now that's a very good question. You know, the thing about physics is, there are layers and layers and layers of knowledge that you need before you can meaningfully ask a research question. And even though I was a reasonably advanced and capable student, I was so far from the research frontier that I didn't even know what the research frontier was. Now, on the other hand, when I went to Fred Richards' introductory biology course, at the end of each lecture, there were so many questions that came to mind, and it turned out they were research questions, and they were accessible, and I just found that incredibly compelling. And so I quickly moved into biology. I was very fortunate that Yale at the time had a program for wayward souls like me called Scholar of the House. It enabled me to spend my senior year doing research and taking no courses.
That is really cool.
And so I spent my senior year doing just that. I, at that point, was sobered enough to recognize that I didn't know everything. And when my dad suggested maybe I should go to medical school rather than to graduate school in a particular biological discipline, I said, okay, that's probably a good idea. And I did. And so I was admitted to Harvard Medical School as an MD student. And the most intellectually enriching couple years of my life, actually, were the first couple years of medical school. Most people find that dull and repetitive and somehow filled with rote memorization. But for me, everything that I had learned or was explained to me was a launching pad for finding out something new. And then I ultimately decided to go into research rather than stay in medicine. That wasn't a difficult decision for me because my bedside manner was utterly lacking. So it was certainly a good decision for me and probably a better one still for the patient. And I joined the MD-PhD program. The MD eventually got dropped, and I ended up with my PhD degree in biochemistry. Now, pertinent to your question about synaptic transmission, which I'm credited with contributing towards the understanding of, and amusingly, I applied at the same time to the PhD program at Harvard in biochemistry. It was called biological chemistry, and in neurobiology. And my first choice was unquestionably neurobiology. And I wanted to study how synapses work. Now, I was rejected by the neurobiology department. I was accepted by the biochemistry department, so I became a biochemist. So when you asked what elicited my becoming a biochemist, it's very simple. I got rejected from neuroscience.
Right. There you go.
And I oftentimes tell this to students because we've contributed a lot, apparently, to discovering how synaptic transmission works, yet I never intended to work on the subject. But it turned out that way. And that's one of the wonderful things about scientific research. If you work on something that's fundamental enough and is foundational enough, then it will impact very broadly. And that's exactly what Randy Schekman and I did. Now, Tom Südhof, on the other hand, in a very determined way, set out to understand synaptic transmission. And in a funny way, all of our projects converged, which is the nature of working on fundamental problems.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And Thomas Südhof, how did you first get into neuroscience?
The bottom line is that I studied medicine, and I became very interested in medicine as I studied medicine, and that really basically made me interested in research. And I did a lot of science while I was in medical school, and afterwards I decided to get more scientific training as a postdoc, and then I that's the story.
Was there a particular aspect of biochemistry that just grabbed you while you were in medical school? Like, I have to study this?
I was just fascinated by the lack of understanding we as a community have about the molecular mechanisms that underlie disease pathogenesis. I wasn't even focused necessarily on the brain. In fact, I did my postdoctoral training with Baum and Goldstein, who are as far from the brain as you can possibly imagine. So it was a general interest.
And how did you first get into studying neurotransmission?
When I finished my postdoc, I was given an opportunity to start my lab in Dallas, where I had been a postdoc. And when I started my lab, I was looking around for potential projects. I decided against continuing a parallel project similar to what I had done as a postdoc because Brown and Goldstein are fantastic scientists, and they had many other offspring who were also great scientists and who were continuing to work in this arena. And so I decided to try something completely new and basically start something entirely different. And I looked around and I thought that we knew nothing about synaptic transmission and how neurotransmitters are released, or very little at least, certainly molecularly, and that that would be a field which might be might allow us as scientists, not only me, but also others, to make progress.
And just to give listeners an idea of the timeline here, when was this happening? Was this in the early 80s?
That was in 1986, October 1986. That's when I started my lab.
Okay. Okay. So what was the first big research project you guys tackled?
My first research project was to try to, so I decided to basically go after synaptic vesicles as the most abundant organelle in brain. That work was also inspired by my doctoral training. When I was a medical student, I performed research in the Max Planck Institute in Göttingen. And although I never worked directly with Victor Whittaker, he was the head of the department I worked in, and his interest were synaptic vesicles, so I knew about synaptic vesicles at that point. I had never worked on synaptic vesicles, but I knew they existed, and I had some working knowledge about what they are and how they're purified. And so I decided to focus on synaptic vesicles, and I thought that the most important goal should be to identify the nature and structure of the proteins in the vesicles, and so we started to clone synaptic vesicle proteins, and we actually cloned the first synaptic vesicle protein a year later. It was 1987, was published in Science, was synaptophysin, and that was the first synaptic vesicle protein that was ever cloned.
Did other researchers recognize the importance of this too?
Yeah, I think so. I do believe so.
So by this point, all three of you guys had pretty much gotten your education. You were getting established in your chosen fields. And it sounds like it wasn't long before you started to realize that all of these seemingly separate lines of research were starting to intertwine. For example, James, how did you start realizing that your genetics research was starting to tie into biochem?
Well, okay, so I didn't actually start out working on synaptic vesicles. I ended up working on synaptic vesicles. So when I started, I don't know how much detail you want, but I learned how to be a biochemist by working with a great biochemist, Eugene Patrick Kennedy at Harvard, who was the leading figure in membrane biochemistry at the time, or one of the leading figures. And I learned how to think and breathe like a biochemist.
What's it like to think and breathe like a biochemist?
Well, I mean, to think and breathe like a biochemist means you think about mechanism all the time. You know, this is actually a fundamental difference. You know, people say today that there isn't really a big difference between, you know, molecular biology, biochemistry, genetics, but there actually are philosophical differences in the approach. So, for example, if you're a biochemist and you want to set up an experiment, you have to have a very clear hypothesis you want to test, because really, it's like a chemical reaction. If you have a chemical reaction, you have reactants, A plus B goes to C. You could have a hypothesis. Your hypothesis would be that A plus B react to form C. So to test that hypothesis, you add A with B and you see if you produce C. In biochemistry, it's always the same thing. There's a pathway that you have in mind, and that, and you have to, in a way, hypothesize that pathway in order to know what reactants to add and what products to look for. Does that make sense? Biochemistry is intimately, through its connection to chemistry, the unique way to elucidate molecular mechanisms, which by definition are in chemical terms. On the other hand, genetics is extraordinarily powerful, for the very reason that you don't have to have a defined, clear hypothesis about mechanism in order to discover machinery. You have to say, oh, I'm very interested in understanding a process, and now I'll be clever and find ways to identify mutations in that process, and those mutations will then identify the machinery for me. And that identification process is so beautiful because it cuts through the complexity and the fog of the complete unknown to yield discrete molecular entities, genes and the proteins they encode. But on the other hand, it doesn't give us a connection between those genes and chemical reactions or how they fall into a mechanistically defined process. That's why genetics and biochemistry are so complementary. And that's why, for example, Randy Schekman's work and my work, to pick an example in this field, have been so profoundly complementary over decades.
So when you started in this lab, you were working from a genetics perspective?
No. So my notion was, what we all set out to do, Randy and I in particular set out to do, was to understand how George Pilates vesicles could form from a membrane and then fuse with another membrane, because that's the underlying fundamental process. And that process occurs, we both imagined, with variation from one part of the cell to another, but there would be some underlying mechanism that would be our goal to understand. Now, my approach was to try to reproduce the process in the test tube system. In other words, knowing that vesicles butt off from, let's say, the endoplasmic reticulum infused with the Golgi in the cell, could you disrupt the cell and observe that that process could continue under some artificial condition? And the reason to do that as a biochemist is it enables you to identify and to isolate the component proteins that are required in the process. So our notion was to conceptualize vesicle trafficking as a metabolic pathway, much as the biochemists in the early part of the 20th century discovered how sugar is metabolized. They found that sugar was metabolized by yeast to alcohols or acids, and they found that they could disrupt the yeast, and even as cell extracts, the sugar can continue to be metabolized. And they discovered a series of chemical transformations that could occur in the test tube, and they isolated the enzymes step by step that were required for the process, and thus came our understanding of metabolism and energetics in the cell. From my point of view, it was no different to think about vesicle trafficking or any other biological process. One thinks of it as a pathway or a process with a series of steps, each catalyzed by a different enzyme. And so if you could reproduce the process, just like yeast fermentation had been reproduced in the early part of the 20th century, and more recently, transcription of RNA, the translation of protein, and very importantly at Stanford University, the synthesis of DNA by Arthur Kornberg, who Randy and I both have in common as a mentor. If that could be done for something even more complex, namely these three-dimensional trafficking patterns in the cell, well, it would open the door to biochemistry, and eventually the proteins would succumb and we would identify them. What Randy did is to take a different approach, a purely genetic approach initially, where he introduced genetics into the study of secretion in yeast, building on the work that Paul Nurse and Lee Hartwell, especially, did, where they demonstrated that something as complex as the cell cycle could be delineated in terms of a series of defined genes. Randy developed novel ways to extend that philosophy into the secretory pathway, found soon enough that the broad outline that Pilati had derived was correct, even in a yeast cell, and then he proceeded to identify these genes one by one and how they fell into place. They fell into place rather closely with the machinery we were discovering, and then we all knew that something big was about to happen.
What about you, Thomas? When did you start to notice that your work was tying into Randy's and James's?
Well, I mean, Randy was the leader together with Sidney Brenner in using unbiased genetics as a way to identify genes that are involved in a particular function. In Randy's case, it's secretion. In Sidney Brenner's case, it was movement of the worm. And they came up with very similar genes often. And so I was a great admirer of both of their work and obviously followed what they found closely. And many of the genes that were isolated that way, we later on, or not many, but some of them, we later on discovered biochemically. And that complementarity, I think, added to the field.
Makes sense. So how were you guys interacting during this period, during the late 80s, early 90s? Did you guys know each other personally? Were you going to the same conferences?
Oh, yes, we knew each other. We were actually rarely at the conferences together because Randy is a very he's a cell biologist. He's a yeast geneticist, and I'm a neuroscientist. So we sometimes met at conferences, but our work is very complementary, but I don't think it ever overlapped.
When did you start to notice that all your guys' work seemed to be converging on really similar answers?
I think that the realization of this fact emerged fairly rapidly in the mid-90s, and others contributed to that as well. There were other yeast geneticists, particularly people Randy trained, like Peter Novick, who had a tremendous effect on the field. And there were structural biologists who really pushed the field. There were biochemists like Reinhard Jahn and Richard Scheller who made significant contributions. So the idea that these various approaches, the neuroscience, the biochemistry, and the genetics, yeast genetics, are complementary, emerged during the 90s, absolutely.
James, you have anything you'd like to add to that?
So you asked how all this converged. Randy's genetics and my biochemistry had begun to converge in the late 1980s and were fully mated by the early 1990s. Now, by that time, Tom Südhof and others, who had been determined to understand synaptic vesicles in particular, Well, they had characterized the synaptic vesicles, isolated proteins from them, particularly Richard Scheller additionally contributed to this. And they identified a series of proteins from the membrane of the synaptic vesicle that were highly concentrated there and therefore thought to be relevant in all likelihood to synaptic transmission. Where my work converged with their work was when we identified what we termed the snare complex in 1993. We knew clearly that NSF and SNAP were very important physiologically in the cell because of Raine's genetics. Biochemically, we knew that they were part of an ATPase system that cycles on and off of a membrane. And we knew also that many membrane fusion processes in the cell required these two proteins. So while they were probably important, NSF and SNAP, in powering fusion in one or another way, they clearly did not account for the specificity, which is a key aspect. In other words, a vesicle that comes from one part of the cell, let's say the ER needs to fuse with a determined target, let's say the Golgi, but another vesicle coming from the plasma membrane perhaps needs to fuse with a lysosome, but not with the Golgi or a mitochondria, for example. Okay? And in that way, the maze of trafficking pathways are kept separate. So what we imagined was that there were probably proteins in the membrane that somehow interacted with NSF and SNAP that were ultimately quite important in the fusion process and probably also important in providing specificity. Now, SNAP protein interacts with the membrane, we found, but the NSF doesn't. But it binds to the membrane when SNAP is already bound. So there must be primarily receptors for the SNAP protein in the membranes for fusion. The abbreviation of SNAP receptor is SNARE. So we set out to identify what we termed snare proteins. Now, parenthetically, I discovered in those days that one of the best motivators for young scientists was to name the protein before you discovered it. So we named it the snare protein. So therefore, we could say, you need to discover the snare protein so that you can publish an article in Nature entitled Snare Proteins Mediating Membrane Fusion. High motivator. I'm joking a little bit, but actually there's truth to it. So in particular, we found that brain membranes, total membranes from brain, had a much higher concentration of the SNAP receptors, the ability to bind SNAP protein. So Thomas Sulner developed a very ingenious affinity purification scheme using NSF and SNAP proteins as the bait, and the fish that he caught was the SNAP receptor snare. So what we did was we isolated the proteins, the SNAP receptors, and we found a very simple composition of the SNAP receptors. There were really just three proteins that we identified there. And the reason we were able to identify them so quickly was because all three of them were already known. They were three proteins that had been previously identified. One was called DAMP, or synaptobrevin, and it was co-discovered, essentially, at the same time by Tom Südhof on the one hand and Richard Scheller on the other. Tom Südhof together with others, I should say. And that was discovered, I believe, in the late 1980s. Another protein in the complex was discovered by Michael Wilson, also in the 1980s, called SNAP25, SNAP25. Bad coincidence, nothing to do with my SNAP protein. It stands for synaptosome-associated protein, 25 kilodaltons. Just complete coincidence. The third protein was called syntaxin and was discovered the previous year by Richard Scheller.
So that was the moment when it really clicked for James Rothman. How did things look from your perspective at that time, Randy?
Yeah, well, we had been in communication all along. During his most formative years, he was at Stanford, and we communicated. It was sort of competitive, I have to say. Pretty competitive, but we were still communicating. And I think it all really clicked when he purified the first protein that he was able to fractionate using his assay, a protein that he called NSF.
Okay. And what was it about your work and James's that seemed to have the potential to really transform the way people studied biology?
Well, before our effort began, and he's a couple years younger than me, but we started around the same time, the field was dominated by classical cell biologists, most notably George Pilotti, who, was brilliant. I mean, a brilliant morphologist. And he had used his own brilliance to deduce the sequence of events in the pathway in the pancreas. But it was a pathway devoid of mechanism, I mean, except in the most broad sense. Pilotti appreciated that vesicles were mediating traffic, but in terms of how protein molecules were recognized and selected and sorted, there was nothing, really very little. So for me, that was a perfect setup because that's where I felt that the techniques of microbial genetics and biochemistry really could take the field to a higher level of resolution, But I felt personally that one had to take a step away from the traditional systems, the mammalian systems that were used, and use something that was amenable to genetics and large-scale biochemistry. And so I chose yeast. Rothman made a different decision, an equally valid one, which was to not worry about genetics, but to go right in and do biochemistry, and he was successful in doing that.
And as you began to publish papers on this new approach, what was the reaction from the biology community? Did people, you know, stand up and applaud, so to speak, or were they more skeptical?
Yeah, this didn't happen overnight. I mean, we both have our stories about rejection, but, you know, we're both pretty arrogant and stubborn, and we're unbowed by the, you know, skepticism. So my first grant was trashed, but, you know, that's because frankly, I didn't have any experience, relevant experience. People were, of course, skeptical that yeast would be relevant. There were all kinds of, sound like silly arguments about not using yeast. And likewise, people were skeptical about what is a traditional entomologic approach. Because just because the field was dominated by descriptive cell biologists. And now I will say that George Pilati, though he was a morphologist, was a brilliant man, and he appreciated these other approaches. He certainly was very supportive of what I was doing, even though it was very different than what he was used to. Frankly, I didn't care. I wasn't too worried about bucking the trend, and I can assure you Rothman wasn't either. I don't think we were too worried about what other people thought.
And so how did your friend Bill Wickner fit into this whole dialogue?
Well, he was, of course, my best friend, he and I talked all the time. And Bill is very similar to Rothman in the biochemical approach, almost strictly biochemical approach. But Bill made a crucial contribution, actually, to the understanding of the role of NSF and alpha SNAP that Rothman had not appreciated. So when Rothman isolated his proteins by this biochemical assay, his observation, and it was a perfectly reasonable conclusion, was that NSF and alpha SNAP were directly involved in the fusion event. And, you know, because you had to add them back to get vesicles fused. So, sounds like it's fusion. And then he used them to isolate the snare complex. And it's a really famous, I think it was 91 Nature paper about the snare hypothesis. So he assumed that NSF and alpha SNAP were actively altering the configuration of the snares to promote fusion. And at the time, Wickner had developed another system to analyze membrane fusion, the vacuole snares, vacuole fusion, which had a lot of genetic and biochemical advantages in yeast. And he deduced, on the basis of his biochemistry, that the yeast equivalents of NSF and alpha SNAP, which are genes called SEC17 and SEC18, actually act to pry snare proteins apart after the fusion event. And that is an obligate step in order to recycle these proteins. And so if you don't pry them apart after the fusion event, things come to a screeching halt, both in vivo and in vitro. So Rothman's interpretation was in fact wrong. Didn't diminish the importance of the proteins, it just placed their action at a step later than the actual fusion event. And I can tell you at first that Rothman was violently opposed to this. Probably the most dramatic Gordon conference I ever attended. There was some pretty pitched battles between Rothman and Wickner.
Oh, you mean public battles actually on the stage?
Oh, you bet. Oh, you bet. Right on the stage. It was science at its best. It was, well, Rothman, you know, he has the courage of his convictions, even when he's wrong. So. But he turned, you know, within the next 6 months, he probably did his own experiments and figured out that Wickner was right. And now, you know, Wickner's view is textbook view. So I'm glad to see that Jim, well, he has perspective on it now. So
by this point, James, you felt that you had pretty well established that snare proteins were crucial for synaptic transmission. All of you guys had isolated and described proteins that nobody had ever isolated before, but you were still trying to figure out exactly what these proteins are, what they're made of, and exactly how they work. So when did those pieces of the puzzle really converge and click into place for you, James?
I learned about this as I was about to give a research lecture at Harvard University. I believe in, actually, do you want to know? I actually have the notes from that lecture. Hang on. On February 12th, 1993, I have my notes framed. That's how significant it was to me at the time. Okay. Thomas read me the sequence, amino acid by amino acid, over the phone 15 minutes before I was to give a lecture. Even at that very moment, we called it the snare hypothesis from the very beginning. Now, that was one of the most painful moments I've ever had in science because it was a breathtaking discovery, frankly, that at that moment in time, only two of us knew. There's a privilege to that that is extraordinary. And I was about to go and give a public lecture on my research, which all of a sudden was dull to me.
Yeah, I can imagine.
It was the most painful lecture, probably one of the worst I've ever given. I don't know how bad it was, but it was probably pretty bad. Because all I could think about was the one thing I couldn't talk about. Because it was too preliminary, and we needed time to develop it. But you asked me, was there a moment in which this truly converged? And I'd have to say that our feelings at that time are now validated by the Nobel Prize in Physiology and Medicine, which, as a centerpiece, has cited this paper and the implications of it.
Yeah, it's hard to get much more validated than that. So when you got that phone call from Thomas, what was the next step? Did you start putting together a new research program?
Yeah, and then absolutely, we mapped it out. And, you know, I came back the next day, and we set on it almost 24 hours a day. Paul Temps was running a sequencing machine 24 hours a day. And we were literally doing a practically 24-hour shift to get this work. We recognized this was a major discovery.
Oh, wow. And what kind of work were you guys doing during those 24-hour shifts?
Well, I mean, it wasn't literally 24-hour shifts, but I mean, we were working 16 to 18 hours a day. Thomas was making preparations. Other people joined the project. It became the major focus in the lab. And within a very short period of time, actually, I'll get you some dates, if you don't mind. So the first sequence was read to me on February 12th. The paper was submitted in final form to Nature on February 25th. That's how quick all that data was.
That's incredible. 2 weeks from initial discovery to submitted paper.
Yeah. And the paper was accepted on March 9th and published on March 25th.
That is one of the fastest publication times I've ever heard of.
Yeah, and it was also accompanied by a letter. So there were actually two articles in the same journal. And it was the most extraordinary experience because those were the days when editors were highly individualistic. And my editor at Nature was called Nick Short, and he deserves a hero's mention. He said that, he, you know, I explained to him this was a big discovery, it was very competitive, all the usual things, and he said, send it to me. And he digested it. He understood it. And then he said, okay, I'm going to send it out to reviewers. I'll send it out to 7 reviewers. And if we get 3 that like it, your paper's published. Doesn't work that way today. That's exactly how it worked. So we got 3 reviews. One was very positive. Another 2, I think, were okay. And a lot of the folks didn't like it at all. But anyway, that's the way it goes. Today, you'd be dead. But he recognized the importance. He then rewrote the paper for us. And one of the most remarkable experiences of my life, again, there's so many stories associated with this paper. How did we get it published so rapidly? Was Nick rewrote the paper, and we were rewriting it when it was already in proof, completely rewriting it. And I was at a meeting in Taos, New Mexico, and I was skiing one afternoon as we were doing this. So, I mean, quite literally, we would get a fax, and the fax would be on thermal paper in those days. And I'd have to go into the lodge, take my boots off, et cetera, get the fax coming out of the machine from London, okay, scrawl my corrections on it, send them back, usually with a phone call, which was difficult to arrange. Then he would work on it while I was on the ski lift and skiing down. Fortunately, my skiing is very slow, so he had time to do that. And we went through 4 or 5 rounds of this, and that's how the paper came out.
That's so cool.
So it's an amazing story.
That is so cool. So at this point, the lab work was finished, and all that was left was to get this thing published.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
So when that paper was published, what was the reaction from the scientific community? How did things unfold from there?
Slowly. At first, it was meteoric. Everybody loved the hypothesis. Everybody recognized that it was a breakthrough. And then what always happens in science is that the new idea really sort of sinks in. And as it sinks in, people say, you know, but what about this? What about that? What about the other thing? So we had a long slog period of quite appropriately, in which we needed to provide concrete evidence. And that happened slowly and in stages. Okay. Now, as the field developed in the fullness of time, you know, and this is, again, a story filled with controversies all resolved, as far as I know, it turns out that the snare proteins have auto-inhibitory domains built into them. the relief of which inhibition by which is important in achieving regulation of fusion. When those are carved away, fusion gets much faster, but never into the sub-millisecond range. In addition, when we and others were able to study for the first time the fusion of single artificial bilayer vesicles with planar bilayers by sophisticated optical single molecule type methods, everyone now suddenly observed that single vesicles would fuse within tens of milliseconds after they would attach. So now it became clear that the snare proteins were not only energetically competent to do membrane fusion, but they were kinetically competent as well to do membrane fusion as it occurs throughout the cell generally, but still far too slow for the release of neurotransmitter. So for the cell, from the cell biology angle, the issue of speed of snare proteins, are they kinetically competent, to use the biochemical term, that all but disappeared. But it remained for synaptic transmission. This is where Tom Südhof especially enters the story. But the answer that emerged is that there is a machinery superimposed upon the snares that freezes the frame of membrane fusion. Okay, and it freezes it less than a millisecond away from the completion of the snare complex. As a result of that, fusion is all but done, even though the membranes haven't merged. And there's machinery superimposed upon the snares that achieves that pinpoint resolution. Okay? We don't yet know all the details structurally of how it works. We're gaining some insights. But Tom discovered that machinery. It's called complexin and synaptotagmin, and the Nobel Committee specifically cited his discoveries in that connection.
So by the time the 90s drew to a close, all of you guys had published some very important papers. The shift from traditional cell biology to a more biochemistry and genetics-based approach was really picking up steam. People were really starting to think about synaptic transmission in a different way. It was no longer focused just on cell biology. They were talking about genetics and biochemistry and molecular biology. And all of these things, these separate fields, biochem, genetics, neuroscience, they were all starting to inform each other. There was so much overlap in what you guys were working on by this time. It had become really clear that describing synaptic transmission was going to take genetics, biochemistry, things that biologists weren't really talking about before you guys had started. And you guys had all watched this transformation take place over the course of your career, motivated in large part by your own work and the work of the people who worked in your labs and who were your friends, and that must have been so cool. And as more people recognize the importance of this work, I know that you, Randy, and James, and Thomas as well, you guys all started to win some awards for it. Randy, did you even allow yourself to speculate at that stage that someday this might culminate in a Nobel Prize?
Yeah, well, I think the first prize that Jim and I shared was the Rosenstiel Award at Brandeis University in 1994. And at that point, we started to be close friends, and then it kind of snowballed after that. I mean, he won plenty of other awards, and I won a few myself, but the major ones we've shared. So, you know, that starts to happen, and then people start talking about this one, and then it becomes an obsession. So when we shared the Lasker, which was in 2002, at that point, you know, people just don't stop talking about what's next, you know, and it's hard to overlook this, especially around this time of year. So every year since then, you know, I'd wake up on that Monday morning and, you know, there'd be no phone call, and I life would go on. And a few years ago, it dawned on me that this was very much like that Bill Murray movie, Groundhog Day. So I wake up and it's the same fucking day all over again. So I shared that with Rothman, and on Monday, when I recounted it to the reporters, I said, but the good news is that at the end of that movie, Bill Murray wakes up and, you know, it's the next day. And so I said, today's my next day.
There you go. So you definitely had an inkling.
Yeah, well, yeah, but inkling means nothing. I mean, really, it means nothing. People claim they, you know, they have clues or hints. That's nonsense. The Swedes are phlegmatic. They don't say anything. You just don't know. And anybody who claims to know is delusional. I mean, all you can know is that, you know, you win a constellation of awards and there's a certain probability that it could happen, but there are plenty of spectacular scientists who won all the awards and didn't win. I mean, you know, in my mind, Saul Snyder is as great a scientist as there is. And he made an incredible discovery, and I for the life of me can't figure out why endorphins and Keflins wasn't awarded the Nobel Prize. It's just ridiculous.
Okay, so I can't resist asking this. What's it like to actually get the call?
Well, it was a sort of a surreal experience for me because, you know, once you get it in your head, because people keep telling you that it's going to happen, it's only a matter of time, I'm sure I'm not unusual in this respect. You sort of live that moment in your head and, you know, how you're going to react. And it gets really boring after a while. And in my case, Sunday night, I had just come back from Germany where I'd gotten some other award. And so I was late and I was tired and I crashed and went to bed at 9 o'clock. And I was dead to the world at 1:15 when the phone rang and I didn't even hear it. And I'm a light sleeper. Normally I would have heard it, but my wife did. And she yelled out, "This is it." And then I started to get up and I was still pretty groggy, and I got to the phone and I was really nervous, shaking. I didn't know what to say until, you know, I heard this very comforting Swedish voice. Then I knew it had happened.
What about you, James? Did you have any idea that the call about the Nobel was coming?
Well, I mean, you know, you get this wonderful call from Stockholm. That's how I found out.
Okay, so that was the first you heard about it. Okay.
Well, I mean, look, to be perfectly frank, I mean, look, Randy and I have shared the last reward, right? 10 years ago or whatever it was. We've received many prizes together for our fundamental work on the cell. Tom Südhof was a recipient of the last reward this year. You know, you hear rumors. We've heard rumors for many years. I remember one time, humorously, we were featured on the Jon Stewart show. You know, what happened to Rothman and Schekman? They didn't get the Nobel Prize this year, whatever, for their work on bubbles or something. Randy has a lot of fun with that video. You know, I mean, so, and people are, you know, you get messages from folks. 10 years in a row, I've been getting emails from Associated Press where you're going to be on Monday morning. So, I mean, it's not as though you're not aware that this is a real possibility. And anybody who tells you they're not is nuts. But I will say this. This is the first year I didn't get a notice from the AP, where are you going to go? Where are you going to be? Which I took to mean that as a good sign, because it meant I was below the radar screen. So anyway, you know, you never expect it, that it's actually going to happen. And it did happen, which is an amazing thing.
It must be, yeah.
It's an amazing thing. And I'll tell you, I happen to sit on the Lasker jury now that selects the Lasker Awards. And so that's been my first real exposure to being on a jury that awards a prize of this general stature. And, you know, watching what happens, it's amazing. There's so many good candidates. And there's so many good prizes. You know, I mean, just this year, this Nobel Prize for Medicine or Physiology, you could imagine, you know, 10 topics that it could have gone for, right? And they would all have been great prizes. And so it's just a wonder of nature that it happens to be, you know, that you're included in it one year. What an amazing thing. What an amazing thing.
And Thomas, when did you first become aware that you might win a Nobel?
It has always been my impression that there's a large number of people being nominated. I was aware that I was being nominated indirectly. Nobody ever told me directly, but you sort of get a feeling for these kinds of things. And I was grateful for anybody even considering the possibility, but I didn't expect this to happen at all, because I am also aware that so many other people are nominated. In fact, I have nominated some myself. And so I think that being nominated for a Nobel Prize is a wonderful thing, because it means at least somebody believes in your work. But there are so many discoveries that I think would really deserve a prize that I think it's wonderful that, I mean, I just feel lucky that they picked us. I have to say that, in general, the Nobel Committee, when there was a certain lack of recognition for prizes for discoveries in neuroscience and in cytology. Neuroscience, arguably, is probably the hottest and certainly the largest section of biology these days. It's not been very successful in treating disease. Maybe, I hope it will be in future. But it is a very exciting field, and it's kind of noticeable that there have been so few prizes in neuroscience. I mean, before the 2000 prize, that was very important. Before that, it's been a long time before there was another prize. It's just not very frequent, right? So I do also find it rewarding, not only, I mean, obviously I'm thrilled to get this prize, but also that it's in these areas, because I think that these areas are very, very, very important for biomedical research.
That's interesting. Why do you think neuroscience work tends to get passed over by the Nobel Committee? Any insight into that?
Yes, I think because there simply are not as many distinctive discoveries, and especially there are not as many discoveries that are linked to a defined process. Most discoveries in neuroscience are, again, neuroscience is a huge field and is rather parcelated. And so I'm sure there will be more prizes soon, no question, because there's so much happening. But it's not that easy to give these prizes. Just having sat on some of committees for other things, it is incredibly hard to actually identify fair and deserved prizes, because you also want to give prizes for things that are actually important, right? And some of the prizes and other organizations have, I would say, been sometimes given for things that are really not that important. And so this combination of difficulty of finding things that are really important, that can be well defined, that can be associated with an identified set of people, makes it extremely hard for the people on the committee to select the right people. Right?
So did that make it surprising for you that the Nobel Committee chose to tie in your work with James's and Randy's?
Well, I thought that it was a logical choice once I thought about it. To be honest, I didn't expect it at all, so I didn't speculate before. But I mean, there's other ways how one could have potentially honored this work, but the way they set it up, I think, is just inherently logical and fits extremely well.
So you really didn't know up until that moment?
I had no idea. I do want to note that for me it's very important to communicate that this is, in my view, a prize that really honors not just us three, but it really honors a broad sets almost of fields, not just one field, from synaptic transmission to the most fundamental cell biology, yeast genetics, my God. So I think that the prize also stands for a program in science, for a program that values a basic understanding of biological process underlying life, that whose understanding eventually will be the fundament for many future discoveries, both in medicine and in biology. I'm glad I got the prize. I'm glad is the wrong word. I'm overjoyed I got the prize. I'm awed I got the prize. But I also feel that this prize is not just for me. It's for a community.
So as James Rothman said, what an amazing thing. What an amazing thing. Huge congratulations to all three of you, which I'm sure you've already gotten plenty of. Thank you so much, James Rothman, Randy Schekman, Thomas Südhof, for being on the Connectome podcast today. You know, like Thomas Südhof was pointing out, this kind of work really demonstrates the importance of intercommunication between scientific fields. You know, today's big scientific questions are never going to be cracked if we all just stay in our own little departments, speaking our own little languages, and never share with each other. So many fields of study that seem totally unrelated now, just like when Randy was working on yeast and James was working on biochemistry in cells. Just as all three of these guys started their careers wanting to answer completely unrelated questions, all those answers turned out to be pieces of a puzzle nobody had been able to solve since the 60s. And I guarantee you, there are problems in science right now, just like that, that we could crack wide open if we would just share what we know and listen to what people in other fields have to teach us. And to all you guys listening out there, you might be wondering, where the hell can this podcast go after three Nobel winners? We've got lots more cool stuff coming up soon, lots of new frontiers to explore. And so, until next time, have a great week, everybody. Go do some science!
Straight up, we so fucking high up, upper echelon.